here at Sovereign Hill.
My name is Josh. If you haven't guessed yet, I'm a blacksmith here at Sovereign Hill. Now, blacksmithing has been around for a very long time. In fact, many historians consider this to be one of the oldest living professions. That being said, does anyone know what a blacksmith actually does?
Shoes horses.
Shoes horses? I suppose we can shoe horses, yeah? That's one type of blacksmith. What else can we do? Yeah. What do you reckon we can do?
Make things with fire. Yeah, we use fire quite a bit, don't we?
Well, no one has said things like swords and knives yet. I guess we can make swords and knives. We can make hammers. We can make anvils. Turns out we can make anything out of iron. In fact, that's what blacksmith is. Black is black metal, which is iron. And smith comes from the Greek word smithos, which means to smite or to hit. So quite literally, we're iron workers, we're iron hitters. So what I've done for you guys today is I've placed a bar of iron into my fire here, and I've begun to heat it up. Just about ready to go, we're looking for a nice bright yellow colour, almost a white colour. Those colours very closely correlate with the temperature of the steel. So basically, the brighter it is, the hotter it is. The yellow heat is anywhere from 900 degrees well up under 1,000 degrees Celsius. So it's very, very hot. So, yeah, it's about ready to take about 10 more seconds to make it extra hot. What I'm making for you today is just an example of a decorative or stylized leaf. So leaf work is very common in ironwork. If you visit old churches, old government buildings, you'll probably see decorative ironwork, and most of that decorative ironwork will have leaves. Anyway, ready to go here, take the bar out of the forge. Start with making a point. So I'll do this by tilting the workpiece at an angle and swinging down at an angle as well. There we go, we've forged a point. We'll move that point over the edge of the anvil, swing half on, half off the anvil. So shoulder the material, isolating it, rotating 90 degrees of the shoulder again. You can see it's a very sharply isolated section of material that's thin as opposed to the triangle shaped, human shaped section that's created. Thin it down a little bit more. Then I'm going to put this on the anvil, do the exact same thing but on the opposite side. So this will be the stem portion of the leaf. It's isolated the thin section. Now you've seen it obviously change shape a little bit now. You've got the triangle section there, you've got the thin section. But you might also know the colour's changing. So the beautiful bright yellow is fading away. Now we go to the dark red. Now hypothetically, I can keep doing this over and over again, and the wood actually start growing again. So you can cause internal stress, kind of friction with your hammer, if you hit rhythmically enough and with enough force, that you can keep the metal hot.
So I understand, we'll just put it back in the fire here, we'll get it up.
Thinner pieces of metal heat up a lot quicker than bigger pieces of metal, so luckily this won't take very long to heat up. Then the caveat to that though, thin pieces also lose heat a lot faster than thick pieces. Basically means we have to have an idea of what we're going to do next before we bring the workpiece out of the fire or the forge here. So I know ahead of time that this next heat, I'll be drying up that stem a little bit more, and then I'll start flushing the leaf. Now I did mention very simply there what this thing is actually called. Did anyone hear that? What is this fire called?
Forge, yeah, that's right.
This is called forge. And the word forge gets thrown around quite a bit with lights in the shop. In fact, sometimes the whole shop is referred to as the forge. Sometimes it's a verb and you have to hit the metal with your hammer is forging the metal, but technically speaking it is just this fire, it is the forge. In my forge I'm burning this black stuff here. It's not coal, it's charcoal. So it's having nine, both made of carbon. Big difference is this is made from once living trees. They made this morning. Whereas coal is often 10,000, not millions of years old in the ground. Anyway, we're ready to go again. We'll finish tapering out this little stem section. There we go. And now we'll start plugging that leaf in this section here. Take a couple of hits to do it properly. Let's get started this particular way.
Now you might want to have it as well as not wearing gloves.
I'm stupid, that's why.
So here we start to creep down now and you hear the sizzle.
That's a bit hot. Luckily, iron's a very poor conductor of heat. Give you 1,000 degrees right here and 6 degrees back here.
As long as you
work your heat out properly in the forge. So that's why I'm not wearing gloves, folks. I'm managing my heat slightly tremendously. Managing it in the forge and out of the forge. I'll be able to cool it down. And the base, another blacksmith, you only need 3 basic things. We've talked about one already. That is the forge. Does anyone know what other 2 things a blacksmith needs?
An
anvil's one. And a hammer.
Yes.
Skill. No, you don't need skill to get a blacksmith. The reason I say you need those 3 things is because with those 3 things, first of all, you can build your skill, right? It does take some time. But more importantly, you can make everything else that you need. So you might see me use other tools like this thing here. This is a pair of tongs. I made these using those 3 tools. In fact, all of those tools you can see there, all the top tools, the swages, the hammers, the tongs are all made using those 3 basic tools. So, if you have those 3 things, you can go to a new place, as long as you can get iron ore, and make everything else. We're basically the pioneers of every single town for the last 2,000 or so years. Pretty important role. Anyway, better if we go here again. Find that leaf a little bit more. And then we'll rotate a hammer around, and we'll use a rounding on the rounding side to actually peel out or dry out the size of the leaf. I'm trying to stay relatively accurate with this, because if we can stay accurate enough, it'll give us
a little wind when we don't have a center of the leaf that indicates the pain. Alright, we've got a cool house, put it back in the forge, heat it up again. Pretty good, we can now sort of heat up a little faster.
Now, to become a blacksmith in modern times, yes, you need those 3 things. It doesn't have to be this expensive, this elaborate. You can get started in blacksmithing for like $5. It's not an expensive hobby, but it does require a bit of space. And if you have neighbours, it does get a bit loud sometimes. Be wary of that. Blacksmithing in the 1850s, it took a bit of a different approach. Quite often you needed to be an apprentice first to really learn the trade. It doesn't have YouTube or books that had that blacksmithing details, much less people often couldn't read, so it wouldn't matter much of a difference. And those apprenticeships, they lasted about 5 years. So 5 years of unpaid work that you'd have to do for someone. Now that might seem like a bit of a bum deal, but it turns out this trade was highly sought after. Another trade of the time was then, of course, gold mining, and a gold museum, of course. Now, unfortunately, as you'll probably learn throughout the day, lots of those gold miners lost their lives in mines. They were very, very dangerous. And even though I'm next to really hot metal all day and sounds very sharp and dangerous to us, as long as I'm relatively careful, I can retire rather early. So my job is quite safe in respect to the professions. But perhaps more importantly, I made a lot of money. A lot of money out here. In fact, I made 4 to 6 times the average trade person's wage. Sparky or something like today, it would work out to be a fair bit of money. Most of us retired fairly early. So a bit of a slow start, 5 years unpaid labour as an apprentice. But then you can start your own shop and look around for killing out here. Now, why would we make so much money? Well, you heard when things go by, right? Raw shoes were a big part of it. A very specific type of blacksmith called a ferrier that makes and shoes horses. But miners also needed tools, right? Things like pickaxes, shovels, buckets. Those things to help them find gold. There's about 100,000 gold miners out here. All of them needed tools.
A lot of money on those gold mines.
Basically, to find gold, you had to come pay me first. Anyway, well, I'll spread out this leaf just a little bit more here. Good time going down the centre. What we'll do now is we'll finish ramping out this this stem portion. I've got this cabinet out of the handle. By the way, these handles are sort of like multi-tools. There's lots of different components, and you'll often see blacksmiths work out of the entire thing. So what the horn here, the step of the cutoff plate, the face of the anvil, part of the ostrich hole, the heel of the anvil, gravity, lots of different things that come into play, and the blacksmith anvil. If you're really curious about these particular anvils, the shape of these anvils is rather important. It's known as the London Pattern Anvil, which you can't guess where that originated. It's right in the UK. It's Germany high. Give me a voice, but they are the most popular anvils here in Australia. So if you see an anvil, or you envision someone working with an anvil, this is probably the design of anvil you think of. Around the world, virtually every culture has their own take. German anvils are known as double beak and double horned anvils. They've got two of these pointy bits, one on the side. Old Scandinavian and Viking anvils were nothing more than square blocks with spiked into the ground. So really the shape of it doesn't matter a whole lot, so long as it's heavy, hard, and has some sort of vertical surface. Now these ones, by the way, are very heavy, about 200 kilos each. You want to get started in Australia? I'd spend $7,000 to $10,000 on one of these things. Buy something smaller. Best thing to start off with actually is an old piece of railroad track. Just make sure it's not going to catch the railroad. Anyway, we'll cool this off one more time. And hopefully we can separate that leaf and the next piece right after this one should take. We're going to taper it off. This is technically known as reverse tapering. So because I'm hitting at this angle, it's actually causing a taper to form in the direction of me, as opposed to the direction of you guys there. A little bit more like here. And as it gets really thin, I'm going to take a bit more care because obviously it could snap off if it's too cold. But one more heat, we'll mock it off, and hopefully we'll be able to add a little spiral to this just for a bit of decoration. Anyway, the shot you're standing in, folks, was an actual shot back in the 1850s. Obviously, it's been remade and it doesn't last quite that long. The man who owned the shop was named Mr. Pilgers. He was one of about 23 blacksmiths here in town. And like another blacksmith, as I mentioned before, he made a lot of money. Unfortunately, it would appear he didn't reinvest in himself very well. And by this, I mean he didn't stick in education. It's all the more apparent if you see the front of this building. What a glaring spelling mistake. If anybody's new today, see if you can spot that spelling mistake for me, so I can have it fixed immediately. Anyway, we'll twist this off of here. Hopefully we've got enough residual heat there that we can twist it off. There we go. Sit down on the anvil for a second. And we'll twist, add a little thing called a scribe to the end of this. Do that manually over the edge of the anvil here. A bit of heat, that's all right. What we'll do now, while it's still a little bit warm, pick it up again, hopefully. There we go. Grab this wire brush, brush off any excess forge scale. Forge scale is this rusty looking stuff down here. I say rusty looking stuff because it isn't that rust, it's oxidized iron. It's super easy to steel, iron. It oxidizes almost instantaneously. And then we'll cool it off after it's been brushed. From there we'll say, thank you folks so much for coming. Please do enjoy the rest of your time here at Sovereign Hill.
And there's a rule.
Thank you.